The vice chair for the parent organization behind the Conservative Political Action Conference, also known as CPAC, has resigned over sexual misconduct allegations against the organization's chairman, Matt Schlapp, the gentleman you see right next to me. Now, he's also urging an investigation into accusations by a Republican operative who claimed that the CPAC leader groped his crotch during Herschel Walker's campaign this past fall. Now, Schlapp has denied the claims. He vehemently denies the claims. However, now we're hearing that there are two other individuals who have made sexual misconduct allegations against him as well. So first, let's get to the details about the original allegation. The vice chair stepping down. We'll read some excerpts from the letter and basically update you all on what's going on here. So earlier this year, as I mentioned, Schlapp was sued for alleged sexual battery and defamation by a Republican campaign operative who claimed that the CPAC leader groped his crotch during a campaign trip last fall. In fact, he said that Schlapp allegedly grabbed my junk and pummeled it at length. And in the lawsuit filed last January in Virginia, GOP operative Carlton Huffman accused Schlapp of groping his genitals while driving Schlapp to his hotel in Atlanta after campaigning for Senate candidate Herschel Walker, who luckily did not win a Senate seat. Now, call logs, texts, and videos provided by Huffman and his confidants in his lawsuit matched his account, and six family members and friends and three Walker campaign officials confirmed that he told them about the alleged incident that night or the next day. Just to repeat, Matt Schlapp has vehemently denied these allegations. But what's really fascinating is that he tried to settle this out of court. That's new reporting from the Daily Beast. Schlapp allegedly made the offer back in March, and it was in the low six figures, to which Huffman said, no, not interested. The offer was turned down. Carlton Huffman then suggested a different amount, a counter proposal. We don't know exactly how much it is. And at that point, Matt Schlapp said no. Now, the American Conservative Union was not notified of Schlapp's offer and they did not approve it. And I'm guessing that also played into the decision made by the vice chair to essentially step down and pen this letter to the organization and the executive board. Schlapp surrogates have also highlighted Huffman's own flaws. This is where things start to get real dirty, right? They're digging up some OPPO research on him, including a restraining order against him for alleged sexual impropriety with two young women in February, as well as his expression of solidarity with white supremacist ideologies more than a decade ago. Huffman has acknowledged and denounced those previous statements as ugly. So we're gonna get to more of the allegations and we're gonna give you some excerpts from the individual who has now stepped down from the organization in just a moment. But first, Cenk, some initial thoughts.
So look, people can do things in the past that they regret. Being a white supremacist is pretty extreme. But what does that have to do with this case?
True.
So he was, you knew he was a white supremacist when you were pummeling his crotch at length. You didn't seem to mind it back then, right? All of a sudden, now that he exposed you, oh, I did opposition research. I found out he's a white supremacist. I mean, I liked him back then when he was a white supremacist, but I mean, but now all of a sudden I'm bothered by it, even though I run CPAC. Please, please. Okay, so now look, you can tell whether things are right or not. Roughly, you never know for sure, and you really got to be on the, you know, jury to hear all the evidence, etc. Of course, but let's keep it real. We all judge in the court of public opinion to some degree. So in this case, what are the different ways that you can tell? The number of allegations. So first, the guy comes out. If it's one guy, could be he's looking to get paid. Could be a thousand different things, right? But now there's two more people that have come out and said there's been the pummeling of crotches, and one guy said he tried to kiss him, etc. We'll get to that, right? So the allegations are piling up, and then it's also the substance of the allegations, right? Sometimes I'll read a story, and I remember reading one about a year ago at some publication where they're like, "Well, we have very important complaints, like they're not hiring enough black models." It was a fashion-related story, and I was like, "Oh, okay, that's really why. That's so weird, right?" And then you read into it, and you find out. No, they're hiring plenty of black models. Just the people, some of the staffers thought they weren't black enough. Okay, that's, then you go, oh, okay, I don't know. I don't know if you're trying to get paid. I don't know what's happening, but that's not a thing.
Okay. How is that not problematic?
Yeah, how about the models that were hired? What do you mean they weren't black enough? Should they have not been hired because they weren't black? No, but you see my point. Like, we're not talking about fringe cases where somebody's trying to get rich or whatever it is. These allegations against them are very substantive with significant sexual harassment, etc.
And they're made by other conservatives. And this is not like some political hit job. You get what I'm saying?
100%. And then the last part of it is internal reactions. Look, you could have two or three people inside any company that are aggrieved. That's normal. I wouldn't say like, wow. But as you're gonna see here, board members are dropping like flies. Mm-hmm. And the board members are the most trusted part of the organization. You could say, hey, there's plenty of board members I hate and are cheesy in the general world, but they're most trusted by that organization. They're the adults that run the place. And so they're not gonna get shaken by a tiny little thing, generally speaking. And these guys are super big advocates of Schlapp and AC and CPAC. And they're going, nah, there's something really wrong here. And so
in fact,
this is a very significant allegation against Schlapp.
In fact, I just wanna make clear that when the initial sexual misconduct allegation came out against Schlapp, the board was unified in believing Schlapp and defending him. But as the discovery process in this lawsuit has moved forward, as more shady details have come out, all of a sudden people are changing their minds, including now the former vice chair of the parent organization, Charlie Gerow. We'll get to him in a moment, but let me give you a few details on the two other sexual misconduct allegations against Schlapp. As the Washington Post reports, in one incident, a staffer said Schlapp attempted to kiss him while drinking late after a work function in 2017. The staffer also provided documentation from that night to the Washington Post showing physical contact that the staffer said was unsolicited. And then in another incident, Schlapp allegedly made unwanted physical advances on someone else's employee during a CPAC business trip in Palm Beach, Florida. This happened in early 2022, according to multiple people informed of the incident. Now, all of those allegations led to the resignation of the CPAC parent organization's vice chair, Charlie Gerow, and the vice chairman of the board of the American Conservative Union announced his resignation on Friday of last week in a letter to other directors that called on them to authorize an investigation, including any additional allegations that they or staff have become aware of. And in a statement released after his resignation, he said the following: I am calling on my former colleagues to authorize an independent investigation into the charges against Matt Schlapp, to conduct an independent forensic audit of the organization's finances, to obtain a written opinion of counsel that the organization is in full compliance with its own bylaws and all applicable law, and to thoroughly review all the exit interviews of the large number of staff who have recently left, you know, shedding some light on people who have resigned since these allegations have come out. Now, his resignation letter also raised some concerns about the organization's potential liability for legal costs in the Huffman lawsuit. And that's according to people familiar with the letter. Matt Smith, who is a member of the ACU executive committee, thinks the resignation was more about personal grievances than anything else. Although with the now growing body of evidence against Schlapp, I would take this following statement with a grain of salt. However, I wanna be fair and read it to you. You could decide for yourselves. So Matt Smith says the following: these allegations are completely fabricated and represent a blatant attempt by Mr. Gerow and disgruntled individuals to force Mr. Schlapp to step down. Only when it became clear that he was not going to be reelected to the board did he fabricate these false allegations. Now, this is the third resignation by a member of the board's 8-member executive committee in recent months. And that's pretty damning, to say the least.
Yes, and so look, I think the financial impropriety is the maybe even more interesting. So when they ask for a forensic audit, that means I think these books are cooked. And I'm not remotely surprised by that. I'm actually surprised that that their head finance guy actually has ethics. I look, fair or not fair, I'm just, as a general thing, I kind of assume that conservative organizations rob their donors. that they funnel money to themselves in ways that they don't let people know about. Like
Project Veritas?
Yeah, I've never seen a conservative organization be honest. Like every time one is revealed to be honest, I'm a little bit shocked. But to be fair to this organization, their head of finance was like, apparently cares about financial impropriety. Already I'm surprised by that. So maybe they were doing things right before, but he's like, now he won't even let me see the books. Well, wait, your head of finance can't see the books? That doesn't make any sense. And another board member says, no, you really gotta let us see the books. That's what the whole point of the board is. And he won't let him see the books. And one of the issues is Schlapp potentially funneling money from the organization and from their donors to himself? Mm-hmm. That's what they should look into, right? And number two is, and now this is just my theory. I think Schlapp wants the organization to get sucked into the lawsuit, which it hasn't yet, but he's egging that on. This is my theory, okay? Egging that on so that once the organization gets involved, he goes, okay, you guys pay for everything.
Yeah, that's not joint a bad legal, theory.
Yeah, joint legal defense, because he doesn't want to pay for it.
Well, one of the issues that the board had, or at least the individual who just resigned, was the fact that Schlapp reached out to the plaintiff in this lawsuit and offered a low six figures settlement. They were not notified about that. They did not know about that. And to your point, Cenk, the now former treasurer who quit back in May said that he does not have confidence in the organization's financial statements. So yeah, you're right to be suspicious of the financial wheeling and dealing that's going on with the organization. I don't think that it's necessarily every member of the executive board who's in on it. I think that the blame, at least for now, based on what we're reading and seeing reported, is placed squarely on Matt Schlapp.
Yeah, so look, I'm amazed by these guys because, so look, he does the financial impropriety, potentially, maybe, we'll see how it goes. But the organization itself is worried that he did it. Okay, that's the kind of slippity slap that I expect. Okay, but when it comes to the sexual stuff, over and over again, the head of a conservative group hitting on guys, trying to kiss them, lunging at their crotch.
Allegedly,
without consent, he assumes those conservative guys are also gay or bisexual, and that
or he assumes that he's entitled to do what he wants with no consequences.
Yeah, no, you're far more right. That is absolutely right. But then it makes me think, Jesus, how many times did he do this? Mm-hmm. Because a guy like that, either one, he has absolutely no self-control, which is entirely possible, right? Or he's done this so many times and he's shocked that the last couple of times didn't work. Normally he can intimidate them into getting some sort of sexual favor out of them. And then they're usually quiet about it because they're conservative. Think about it, if you're a sexual harasser, who would you target? Would you target someone on the left who's very likely to speak out against it? Or would you target someone on the right, especially in same gender issues, where you think that person is very unlikely to speak out about it, right? So those conservative staffers are an enormous target for a sexual harasser, yeah, especially in the same gender.
I think that this is true of pretty much any context where you're dealing with a significant power imbalance, right? I really do think that someone like Matt Schlapp felt that he was above any consequences for his actions, if it is proven that he engaged in the sexual misconduct. But the other thing that I am curious about, look, he wants to settle this case. He doesn't want to go to trial. And the discovery process is brutal, right? I think through the discovery process, potential financial improprieties will come up.
No, he's got to settle. I'm telling you, I think he's waiting for to agitate the guy enough that he sues the organization, which has more money and deeper pockets anyway, because he can't, he probably can't afford the defense overall, and B, he can't afford the settlement overall, is my guess. And why am I guessing that, by the way? Because one of the sources in one of the stories said, this is all he has. If he loses this job, he's a goner. And so he's got to hold on to the job for with dear life, but then if he's dismissed from them, especially and he has to pay the legal defense. He's totally sunk, right? So he's got to attach that liability to the organization so they can pay for his defense and they can pay for the settlement. Again, that's my conjecture, but it's informed. Look, I think the Pumley, by the way, is kind of a cheesy move to release the settlement talks, but and usually you're not supposed to do that, etc. But I look, he's aggrieved, whatever, right? Bottom line is, if they go to discovery, Matt Schlapp is in a world of trouble. He must settle this case.
Don't settle, Matt.
Yeah, and by the way,
we believe in you, Matt.
By the way,
go for it. Go for the trial, Matt.
No.
Do it.
Seriously, Matt Schlapp and his wife Mercedes Schlapp also being sued for defamation. If you guys really think you're right, go for it. Go to the trial.
Definitely go for
it. And discovery will help you then.
It definitely will help you.
Right. That way you'll get evidence showing you did no financial impropriety. You never sexually harassed anyone.
Totally. Exactly.
You'll get them on tape. You'll embarrass them,
etc. You need to prove your innocence. And the only way to move forward is to not settle. Go through the discovery process. Go through the trial and prove your innocence. We're looking forward to it.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.